to begin by requesting our first panelist, Mr. Khalid Raza, Captain Mahesh Bhakuni, Mr. P.K. Gupta, Mr. Piyush Govind, and Mr. Anil Jha sir to kindly come up on the stage and have a seat, and we can begin by starting off by lighting our lamp.
Did you know we humans across the globe consume around 4 trillion cubic meters of fresh water every year? And managing and retreating this wastage efficiently would mean almost guaranteeing a water-sufficient future.
That's huge, Tanya. But since you talked about resource management, let me ask you this. Did you know that the amount of energy that reaches from sun to earth in 1 second, if harnessed efficiently, can provide for the electricity needs of the entire planet for an entire year?
Whoa! Well, that definitely establishes the impact strategic resource management can have on our lives.
Indeed. But let us park a discussion on natural resources for a later date and draw our attention towards a resource that involves company, people like me and you. A resource much talked about in the industry, yet so little in academy.
I know what you're talking about, Abir. And it makes complete sense. After all, we have such an experienced and august panel today to know and learn from. The who's who of the HRs in India, who can share their perspective, their narrative, through their very own learnings and lessons.
So what are we waiting for?
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls.
A very warm welcome to all of you to the 12th HR Strengths Meet.
In association with HR Success Talk and BML Munjal University.
HR Success Talk is a platform for HR professionals, leaders and students to exchange their knowledge and experiences. This platform shares ideas through social media for those who have a continued interest in people management and organizational development practices, sharing HR expertise, case studies and articles that trend globally, promoting social learning and building a social network of HR experts. Tanya, HR Strengths Meet is an ongoing annual meet between industry and academy where BMU hosts some of the most distinguished and decorated professionals from diverse industrial backgrounds. Here, they discuss some of the most burning and relevant matters that fall into and beyond the realm of human resources. And our today's theme is employee engagement. You tell me, what is employee engagement really?
Abir, I'm glad you asked. Employee engagement is a fundamental concept in an effort to understand and describe both qualitatively and quantitatively the nature of the relationship between an organization and its employees. An engaged employee is defined as one who is fully absorbed by and is enthusiastic about their work and thus tends to take positive actions to further the organization's reputation and interests. To sum it up, an engaged employee has a positive attitude towards the organization and its values. Involvement, commitment and productivity are contributors to desirable levels of employee engagement.
In the day and age of such extreme dissatisfaction, and constant quest of millennials for the famous job satisfaction, I cannot wait to hear it from our esteemed guests, what their take on the subject is. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, with a huge round of applause, please join me in inviting our first panelist for the day, Mr. Khalid Raza.
An HR professional focused on leading the talent acquisition, Asia-Pacific and management development program for Altisource. Key focus of his work to date has been talent acquisition, talent development and operations, people management and social business consulting. He is also an IBM Corporate Service Corps member. In 2016, he was named among one of the top 25 HR executives under 40 by the reputed Workforce magazine. Ladies and gentlemen, a big round of applause for him. Our second panelist for the day is Captain Mahesh
Chandra. An HR professional having more than 27 years of experience in diversified fields such as manufacturing, construction, real estate and media. A management graduate, Captain Singh also served for the Indian Army in one of the elitist regiments in Armored Corps as an officer. Currently, he is Director HR in Asian News International ANI, one of the largest news agencies in the country and heading HR department. Can we please hear it for him? Next, we have Mr. P.K. Gupta.
Currently working as a general manager HR with TechCorp Limited, he has over 30 years of corporate experience, is certified trainer and has a diploma in training and development from ISTD New Delhi to his credit. Prior to this, he has worked as associate professor and head of training and placement with leading national and international business schools in New Delhi. He is a life member of National HRD Network, Delhi Chapter and Bharatiya Vidya Bhavan. A big round of applause for him. Joining him, we have Mr. Piyush Govind.
Currently associated with Infosys Softwares Private Limited as Associate Director Human Capital, he's a BTech Electronics and Telecommunications and Certified Project Management Professional with over 22 years of varied experience. He started his career in IT infrastructure, moved into core software development, and then into human resources. He has also been into entrepreneurial journey for around 3 years. He loves drawing cartoons, designing advertisements for print media, and a lot of creativity every moment. Can we please hear it from Mr. Govind? We also have Mr. Anil Kumar Jha.
A dynamic HR and business leader with management education from FMS Delhi University and general management course from IIM Ahmedabad, having over 35 years of experience in field of HR in areas of generalist HR, training and development, recruitments, industrial relations, employee welfare, attrition management, performance management, general management operations, HR policies and change management. He is ex-group HR head from Himgiri Automobiles, having 23 showrooms and workshops in Delhi NCR. Can we please have a resounding round of applause for our audience panel for today?
Now, we have Ms. Deepti joining us from HR Success Talks to tell us something about.
A warm good morning to all of you. I hope all are doing well and great. Thanks everyone, thanks to all panelists for being part of this panel discussion. My name is Deepti and I'm associated with HR Success Talk since the beginning. HR Success Talk is a network of HR, by HR and for HR. It's like it has been founded in year 2013 and currently we have 25,000 plus members associated with our community. What we do in HR Success Talk, we organize learning sessions in corporates, education institutes to spread knowledge about the HR. We organize many free online certifications. We have our HR forum where people get queries. People get answers for their HR related queries and we don't charge for this initiative. Now we have our digital presence in WordPress, HR forum, Facebook, LinkedIn, Twitter, and you can also subscribe our YouTube channel. This is our Facebook page. Guys, please do like us and keep yourself updated about the HR world. This is our Twitter handle, you can follow us on Twitter as well. This is our YouTube channel where you can watch the video interviews of a lot of HR professionals on various HR topics. This is our HR forum. These are the advisory members of HR Success Talk. Mr. Govind Negi, Mr. Rajeshwar Biswas, Mr. P.K. Gupta, Mr. Rahul Jain, Mr. Ms. Rakhi Nagpal, Mr. Himanshu Singla, Ms. Saloni Kaul, Captain Ranjan Rawat and Mr. Piyush Govind. These are some of our events in which we have our previous events in which we had Mr. Abhay Kapoor, Mr. Arindam Chaudhary. Right, if I remember, last year also we had our panel discussion with BML Munjal only in the month of November itself. Earlier we have covered few topics like on the performance management, competency mapping, role of HR as a business partner, expectations of HR from the organization, etc. You can also join us on WhatsApp to keep you updated. Thank you so much.
Now, we call upon our moderator for the first panel discussion, Mr. Khalid Rizal, to start the proceedings.
after a lot of weight and a lot of information that has been shared, I hope you guys are excited about learning regarding employee engagement. Are you?
Yes, sir.
I am, and I'm joined by an esteemed panel. You heard about them. It's kind of funny that their experience is almost like my age, so I'm here to learn as well. We will try to finish it up quickly so that we can take more questions from you. So while we are discussing, if you have a question, write it down so that you can ask the panelists later.
So let me just open it up with a very, very broad question. Anybody can pick it up. It's around the differentiation between employment and engagement. Generally, we understand if somebody is employed, they should be engaged. But what are your takes on that? Good morning. The question is employment and engagement. You know, everyone is employed in the organization, full-time or part-time, but it does not mean that he is engaged. Engagement is when the employee feels very passionate towards his work, when he is aligned with the goals of the organization, and when he is committed to his profession and he's proud of his organization, his people, his designation, his position out there. So these kind of people are called engaged people. So engagement is how do you feel as an employee, how passionate you are towards your goal, how passionate towards your organization's success and growth. And as a manager, how do you feel when you find that how many people are keen to work under you, how many people are keen to work under your command. They feel passionate that our boss or a manager is one of the best leaders in the organization. And as an organization, how do you feel when so many people, how many people are keen to work under your company? So these are the three parameters, three stakeholders. First is the employee, second, the manager, and third stakeholder is the company. So if these three things are in align, then that is called where the people are highly engaged. Employed means it's just you are, like we call it, time pass kar raha hai. Samay nikala. These are the words we do. Whereas an engagement is, like in Hindi, they say, when you are mansa vacha karmana. Manse, by your mind, by your soul, and vacha, by your bani se, which I'll clarify later, and karmana, when you are working also with your hands. So engagement is when your mind, soul, heart, your knowledge, your skill is in place and your hands also are working towards the organization. So employed, you have now clearly understood. Employed means the employed person is just passing his time, he's counting the time when the time is getting over, he's waiting for the lunch, or he's just doing a kind of sleepwalk in the organization. These are the people. Employed means everyone is employed, but there are people who are engaged. And you know, there are three kinds of people who are engaged. Engagement is of three kinds of people. Like one is engaged, highly engaged, those who are very passionate. So you know, you'll be surprised. Today it is one of the biggest challenges in the world. And can you guess how many people, what is the percentage of people who are engaged? Any wild guess? Five. Say loudly, 20%. Anyone else? Okay, I'll spell out. There are around, it varies from country to country. Otherwise, average if you take, it is 30.5%. And there are the other category of people. Those who are not engaged. So not engaged kind of people are around 51% or something. You can calculate later to make it 100%. And there are one more category. It's a very interesting category. You can find. Why I am telling you, you can always look for these three kind of people in the organization, in private life, anywhere. And the third kind of category is actively disengaged. These kind of people are always disengaged, but they are very active. And these kind of, now I'll come to the second category. Second category is not engaged. Not engaged kind of people are, they are working, but it's very difficult to find them. आप उनको ढूंढोगे तो आपको मिलेंगे ढूंढते रह जाओगे जब तक कि आपको you have to find where they are actually. Because they are normally sleep talk, sleep walk, and they are the people who are silently working. They just do that much work which can save their naukri, because they save their job. And these kind of people are not contributing, but they look busy doing nothing. But the third category is very dangerous. That's why they call it actively disengaged. They are very active. They are normally talking all negative things about those people who are engaged. Anyone who is working hard, anyone who is working towards the organization, they are sarcastic towards them, they are taunting them, and they are the ones who create a negative kind of atmosphere. So these three kind of people, and now you have to also see, as students, I would like to address you in such a manner, how many of you are actually engaged? Engaged means how many people are actually conscious about the ultimate goal of your life, ultimate goal of your family. Because we are also in day-to-day life, are we busy in WhatsApp or all those things? Are we are really busy walking here, there, looking very busy when the professor is walking, you're active, walking very fast, trying to read, but actually not absorbing anything. So what ultimate aim is to achieve something passionately and get the goal. So that means that is the engaged. And these are the three categories I wanted to tell. And employed is just, I told you, ki one of the my farewell parties, one of my jawan said, ki, sahab ne bahut achha samay nikala. So I felt very bad, ki maine kya sachmuch samay nikala. But innocently he had said that. Thank you. I subsequently have been.
Thank you so much. I think you touched upon really interesting perspective. Anyone would like to add anything?
Hello. Yeah, good morning, students and my colleagues. I would only like to add here one small example from my college days. You know, like you, we were also students at some point of time. So I was studying in pre-medical in DAV College, Chandigarh. Now there was a sick student from a rural background who used to sit by my side. And when the teacher will be writing something on the blackboard, he'll be scribbling something on his notepad. And he will not look at the blackboard. So the professor, while writing on the blackboard, saw that this boy is not listening to me and he's doing something else. He just made him stand and then asked him, come on the blackboard and write what I was teaching, just to prove that he was not listening to what he was saying. So that student went to the blackboard and he wrote not only what he was teaching and even that part which he was going to teach subsequently. He said, I am not writing what you are teaching right now. I am writing the next chapter. Okay, so that, you know, I was in pre-medical, so that boy got selected in MBBS and I was, you know, I was not selected. Okay, so this is the level of engagement. I am just giving an example. As students, you can be engaged to this much level that you are moving faster than the professor who is teaching you. Study the material that is being taught on daily basis. See what is going to be taught to you the next day. That speaks about your engagement. Okay? So this is just an example for you as students.
I think it's a brilliant example. If you look at it from the perspective of engagement, a lot of people confuse engagement with happiness. So you feel that organization is doing a pay decoration or a fancy dress competition, and you say, you know what, a lot of being done in my organization towards engagement. But is engagement really about making people happy? So we're going to talk about it. I think we're just scratching the surface here. I want to ask both of you, is there a way we can measure engagement? Now when we know that we're talking about happiness and engagement differently, how do we do that? I know historically we have done annual surveys.
See, measurement is not so easy. Very few companies in India or the world are doing it.
Hello.
Yeah. So what I'm saying is measurement is very difficult and it cannot be done in-house. I have not been done in-house. Gallup does it, Mercer does it, Hibbett does it. But it is a very, very crucial process. But what I would like to say is there are indicators. You know, engagement, it applies to everyone. It applies to students, it applies to employees. You know, the magic words are passion. As a student, whether you are passionate about what you are studying, you know, and it can be actively engaged, as Dr. Mahesh said, or partially engaged. Indicators are there, whether you are engaged or partially engaged or disengaged. But then measurement, you have to get it done from outside the agency, not in-house. It is very dangerous to do it in-house. We can do survey, we can have a general survey, but measurement is difficult.
So, Piyush, any pointers on?
Let's bring currently the organizations are doing the measurement about engagement. So what actually they do, they do internal surveys, anonymous surveys, where employees come up with their inputs. And those we need to study and work upon. Like we do year-end surveys, like we can plan for the next year's strategies. And the regular measurement is like beyond surveys, we have to do one-on-one talk. We do a lot of discussions with employees. Because, as I said, the indicators are there. So we keep talking because it's not a HR responsibility. The managers, the functional managers, they are more day-to-day connected with the employees, means with their team members. So they know more where the person is not engaged and with the, where the disengagement is going on. So they have to keep talking to them when they come up the difficulties, and then they can bring up to the management, senior management, and what is going on and how we can work on the improvement areas and how we can increase more engagement, like where we can engage them to do various activities and being, because it's very important for an organization to sustain a long-term sustainable for them.
Okay, thank you.
Very rightly said by one of the panelists, like there are indicators. I'll just spell out some indicators, like what is the absenteeism rate there? One, in case the people are engaged, you will not have absenteeism. They will wholeheartedly at the workplace. Even Sundays they would like to come, those people who are very passionate. Same thing goes with the students, like you will not be scoring good marks or you will be attending good programs which contribute in your career. Secondly, the turnover, attrition would be very less. And in case the employees are engaged, the employees' turnover will be less. The productivity will go very high. In case you don't have any surveys do indicate, but otherwise these are the symptoms. Ye lakshan hai iske ki kitne log yahan par engaged hain, how many people are engaged. The productivity will be very high, and of course the profit will be high, sales will be high, your customers will be talking very high of you. In case your family member, in case you people are very good students, you are engaged, so people will call ki wo BML students are very good. So this is a way of communicating. You become the brand ambassadors. So those employees who are engaged, they talk good of employer. And these are the few indicators, and also the safety would be highest. Otherwise, in case I worked with the construction industry, where the accident, one of the industry, you had a lot of accidents, there will be safety. A lot of safety will be there. So these are the few indicators. A lot of indicators are there where the people are motivated, people are working towards new goals, and they are also growing in the organization, and the organization also has a tremendous growth. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll again give an example from your college, for college students, so that is relevant for you, and you'll be able to relate it a little better. Like talking about measurement of engagement. See, those students who will be engaged in their studies, who will be more engaged, they'll be get getting good marks. Their absenteeism will be less. They'll be, you know, what do you call, bunking their classes very less. Okay? So those students, so padaku students, jinko bolte hain, ke, you know, they are more engaged. They get good marks. You can say that this boy or this girl is more engaged. And then they'll be attending their classes to the maximum. They will not be absenting. They will not do bahana bazi for, you know, they'll complete their assignments in time. And so these are some of the indicators. Like my colleague said, that in organizations, we will have more productivity, more profits, less absenteeism, less wastage. These are all indicators of engaged employees. More retention, less people leaving the jobs. So all these are indicators for in the employment scenario, in the companies. But in students, as I told you, these are some of the indicators. And also I would like to add that, you know, merely getting good marks or just being studious is not enough. You should learn also. You should actually learn. Try to learn. Learning is more important. That is going to help you when you go for employment or become an entrepreneur. We as HR professionals, when we interview students like you, we see the learning, the knowledge of the student or the candidate. So try to focus on learning along with focus on engagement. Be more engaged, have more learning attitude, and try to learn as much as possible, because this is the time that you have for learning. This time is not going to come again. So make best use of it.
Thank you. I think that's a very brilliantly put. I always thought when I was in college, I was an engaged student, but I never got scores. That's a different story. But what you mentioned is impactful in terms of employee engagement as an annual religious activity that we do, wherein on a daily basis, through productivity, through turnover, through attrition, you can actually sense whether your population is engaged. So I think that's a really interesting perspective. So Piyush, let me ask you a question here. What can orgs do to make employee engagement a strategic priority for them and not just an exercise which happens on an annual basis?
Let me start with why it's required. Basically, like what's happening currently, the organizations, they're comprises of millennials, more than 60%. And maybe if not, in a couple of years, the population is growing. So the thought process that millennials, the engagement is about in the workplace is totally different. They have a complete transformation. What they look at the workplace and what a traditional workplace is. So every organization has the rules of engagement has changed. So, and this, the new generation which is coming up, they're very, you can say, digital world, they're very digital savvy. They're more connected on social media, they're very well connected. So when they're so much proficient, when they're entering into an organization, so organization has a challenge like how to engage them, basically. Earlier what we used to do, we do a lot of programs so that employee can engage. But now the concept has changed, like we have to engage them to learning. Like because even if we see like every 30 seconds, people are going to their mobile and checking something. So this is how we have to change the concept. We have to bring the learning into that space, how we can engage them. Second part, like, they are, when they're entering the what now that what organizations has to do for the strategy priority, like, so they have to, as in the new generation is coming up, they're looking for a flexible organization. They do not want to work into 8-to-5 kind of a environment. They want to work from anywhere, like to come. They're looking for continuous feedback about themselves rather than they paid for the annual performance feedback. They are the kind of strategies which organizations bringing up the priority. secondly, anyway, they need to a kind of a fun element into the work while they're working. So organizations also trying to engage them through various kind of apps which are adding into the during the work period. Secondly, they also want to pursue their hobbies. So organizations are trying like how to engage them and have some time devoted for them, so that they can at least they can do their activities, CSI activities, kind of they are more coming up. So these are kind of strategic priorities which organizations has to come up. And
okay.
Dig in.
All right. You brought a very interesting point to perspective, and I'm sure a lot of our audience would be interested in this. Are millennials really different from normal human beings?
It's not normal human beings, but the time is changing. We are well connected on the social media, we are well connected digitally. So we are well, means everyone is so connected. Even if I say in an organization, if a team, they are connecting to the boss's boss easily.
So you mean to say from the technology perspective, we need to, okay.
So that we have to engage because
that makes perfect sense.
Because of the traditional people that we used to get, we be learning, okay, they have a classroom training, so we are happy with that.
Sure.
But now they have to be engaged, and so
ability
is
what's from academic point of view, I would say the strategies are to be well placed. As an HR professional, I see the beginning from you are the brand ambassador. So is your employees are also brand ambassadors. Like what happens, strategic point of view, say if you take anyone from the reference, so it also speaks volumes about your organization, because the employee who is existing there, he is feeling like that the other person also joined you. So that engagement process starts from there. So therefore, the onboarding process, anyone who is being inducted anywhere, if the onboarding is very good, he will stay there. And they say 91% people will stay at least for 1 year in case your onboarding is very good. Like you have in the Indian Army or any good organization, Tata's and etc., this onboarding is very good. My colleague said training and development, further than communication, the fair process has to be in place. What we call fair process is you explain to the employee what he's supposed to do. Then you engage first, you hire a person, then you explain, and then you expect. So these three things are to be done in a strategical manner so that employee, the day he's boarded, he knows what his future lies ahead. And subsequently, then communicate. There has to be a constant communication and connect between the employee and the management. And that time the HR plays a pivotal role. And third is your training and development. You should give enough opportunity to your people to grow. In case they are doing any course, in the organization should sponsor it, can you sponsor it, and also the manager can be a mentor. The fourth part is also mentoring, where the mentoring has to be in place. So these are the few things coming to my mind. There are a number of things which you can have a fun place, you can have best employee of the month, small strategies which go a long way. And those are the things which keep you engaged and employee feels proud, and there is a sense of belonging, sense of purpose in the employee. And same thing, if he contributes, the manager also feels how many people are under his command and he's also contributing as a mentor. An approach has to be three-tier: the lower level, the middle level, and the higher level. It has to be top-down approach. So these strategies, if they are well placed and ethical things, and also the policies of the company, they also play a major role in having employee engaged. Thank you.
Thank you. So let me ask to the audience here, some of them are actively engaged, some of them are actively disengaged right now, which I can see. How many of you think, raise your hand, how many of you think that it is employer's responsibility to engage employees? Let me repeat my question. How many of you think it is employer's responsibility to engage employees? It's okay, raise your hand, I don't know your names. It's like around 5-10%. So everybody believes that it is our responsibility to engage ourselves, is it? How many of you think it's your responsibility to engage yourself? And some of them never understood my question. So that's okay. So let's come back to, Anil, I want to ask you, what could be some of the creative examples that we can look at in employee engagement, which I'm sure you must have done in your glorious career. What organizations can do creatively to engage their employees?
As an HR professional, we have been constantly, being alert to judging, seeing how much engagement level is there in the employees. I'll tell you, 20 years back when I was working in a company in Bombay, we realized that, and Gallup, we got a survey done from Gallup, and it was confirmed that, more than 50% were disengaged. So we didn't know what to do. Then we thought, we have to do something. So we did OT intervention exercise. And that exercise started from the top management, from director level. And it was done by Homi Mulla, who are the managerial grade experts. And their strong belief was the engagement activity has to start from the top, from the directors down. And we started that exercise. Small groups were created, directors, then general managers, then managers, and group of about 15-20 people. And they were taken to Lonavala 1 week. Massive brainstorming, group exercises, group works, group activity, even directors were made to do it. So, after about 6 months of this intervention, we could make out the difference, among the attitude, among the, of the top management, of the middle management, of the senior management, the disconnect that was there between the various categories of employees, that seemed to be vanishing. There was closer bonding, closer group activity. So, in a company I was working in Lucknow, I was asked to start the HR department. There were about 500 employees. And you will not believe, there were no policies, no manuals, no rules, regulations, nothing. And I was made to do everything. Now, I went around the factory, I went around the office, corporate office. I didn't know how to start, where to start. And there was complete disengagement. Everybody who had a grip against performance management, they said, increments are subjective, wo favor karte hain, partiality karte hain. I started an open forum discussions there. That was straight out of Jack Wells' recommendations. I held open forum discussions from workers, middle management, senior management, what they wanted, where was the disconnect, what was lacking, what they wanted from the management, what they wanted from the employees. And then we started from the scratch. We started organizing picnics, we started organizing get-togethers, we started organizing, I had to lay down the performance management. So I had to conduct a series of meetings for the KRAs, making KRAs for our management executives, explaining to them the process. And it took me about 6 months to 1 year time. But then you could make the difference. The engagement levels, the active involvement of all the employees. And the major issue is you have to continuously communicate. Continuous communication is very, very important. Because, people have to be told, people have to be made understood what management desires from them. And that is the disconnect. So, it worked beautifully. It took about 6 months to 1 year. Various activities, picnic, get-togethers, celebrations, brainstorming sessions. But then it worked. Now, in other companies that I've worked in, we used to have Diwali get-togethers, we used to have family picnics, we used to involve families in the company activity, so that family also connected to the company. Because you see, attrition, what happens, you know, if the employee is disconnected, but if the families are connected to the company, then they put a pressure on the employee. We don't leave this company. This company is very good. Like that. So, this is how it is. The one thing is, the magic word is passion. You know, you have to, when you are looking for indicators, you have to look how passionate people are, how passionate employees are for the company, how committed they are, and that applies to students also. You know, students, there are classrooms, there are lectures, some will be sleeping, some will be walking out, some will be going out. That shows their engagement levels. That shows how committed they are, how passionate they are about the course. Or they have been made to do this course, not out of choice, but out of force by their parents. So, this is what.
Very interesting point that or rather that word passion that we've been hearing for a long time. And I've never seen any employee in my lifetime, which is very limited so far, who's not passionate on day one. Everybody is. And I had talent acquisition, I see lines of people, all passionate. But what happens to that passion on day two? Where does it go? And let me ask you a question, since you worked in armed forces itself. What happens in army and how do you correlate it to what's happening in corporate world today? How do our jawans, our officers are engaged and I don't know what happens there because I've not served there, and compare it with what's happening in the corporate world?
Thank you for asking this question. So I served Indian Army as an officer. So since I love people, interacting with people, and it was definitely doubled my passion towards my people. So the slogan, that caption in Chirpur Hall in IMA Dehradun, it's written, if I correctly remember, they say the country you serve, the well-being and welfare of the country you serve comes first and foremost. The troops you command, the men you command, comes next. And your own welfare and your own well-being comes always last but always and every time. So this is the value taught to the people, officers in the armed forces. So that further filters down to the jawans. So there is a camaraderie there. You are first to, like, I'll correlate with the HR also here. What happens? You should know your people you command. Unless you know your people fully, you can't really take care of their welfare. What happens in armed forces, there are 2-3 colleagues here who belong, their background is army and defense services. What happens in the army, anyone who joins as a young officer, for first couple of months, he used to spend time with his troops in place. Like if you have Kumau regiment, if you have Garhwal regiment, or any particular regiment, so that officer will take the trips of those areas where he will find in what conditions my jawan is living there. So that brings him closer to the jawans. Secondly, the training and development part. It's very intense because after all, at the end of the day, you have to be fighting fit and you are also, the motivation level is so much that you are asking for the ultimate sacrifice, giving your life. You must have heard the story of Vikram Batra, who said, "Ye dil maange mo." He was just 25 years old, in 99 in Kargil War, he died. And that was the time, that was the passion, that was the most difficult terrain he was fighting. And what was motivating him? It was just passion. He was so engaged with his job, he was so engaged with his soldiering that what happened in the extra incident before that, when he was chasing the terrorists, one bullet came towards him, he just lost and it hit the jawan next to him. So he was so emotionally moved. He says, he writes to his sister, "Didi, jo goli mere liye bani thi, wo mere jawan, mere colleague ko le gayi, mere colleague could, and I will not leave that terrorist. And whole night in search operation, they found that terrorist and killed him. This was the passion. This was the honesty towards his job. So this was Vikram Batra, who was posthumously given the highest award, Paramveer Chakra. Now, since he has asked this question, I'll now relate to it in the private sector. You've heard about 26/11. Anyone who's, who doesn't know about 26/11, 26 November 2008, the Mumbai Taj Mahal Hotel was under siege of terrorists. Now, I'll just narrate a small story there. What happened for 2 days, for 3 nights and 2 days, for 2 nights and 3 days, it was the completely it was under siege. The army, NSG, the commandos were trying to kill the terrorists. And you'll be surprised, and 10 locations of this attack took place, 150 people died, and 11 people alone are from Taj Hotel. And you'll be surprised, not even a single person ran away. They knew the escape routes, they knew the path, nobody went. Some Khan was the general manager. His family was staying in 6th floor. That time, the family was completely burnt. They died because the terrorist had set it on fire. He was still serving the people. There were people who had put a human chain and surrounding the customers. And there were telephone operators who evacuated the guests and came back. They could have ran away. After some time, then there was a research was done. The Howard team came to India. They tried to ask these people, what was the behavior? Why this peculiar behavior of these people? They could have saved themselves, but still they were there. So nobody could tell the answer. Then some Rohit Deshpande, he was a professor in Howard. He did research for almost 9 months. Then he came out with one thing, that these people, why these people were working for the guests, these people were from the normal cities, from normal background, from second B-class cities and B-class colleges. They had ethical values deeply ingrained them. And the HR practices were so high that the hiring and onboarding was very good. And these people, like you can also find people who are from common background, they have ethical values deeply ingrained them. So they found this behavior was because it took, they were from a very common background. The ethical values were very high. Like he said, ki, how many you are engaged? So these values come from your families. Jahan par bola jata na, atithi devo bhav. Hum log apne logon ke liye kis tarah se jaan dete hain. That is what you must have seen most of the army people. They come from villages. That deeply ingrained in them. Then Ratan Tata went to one of the deceased families. So he found, he was a little scared. There was a photograph, and garlanded photograph, the lady says, he's my husband. Now, my children do not know he was a brave person who died for the guests. And whereas Tata, Ratan Tata had imagined he may face some kind of, you know, anti-feeling towards them, towards him. So there are three things. Onboarding, the recruitment part is very important, where the HR plays a very, very important role. Secondly, the training and development. They train these people like anything. And the third is reward system. What happens in Tata Hotels, a guest who is staying there for 24 hours, he normally meets a person for almost 42 times. So anytime, if any good incident happens, the person is immediately rewarded. So these are the things which makes a person very passionate and very, very hardworking and engaged. Subsequently, you must have seen so many stories like Nirja Hanut. She died for, she also knew she could have escaped. There are 3 crew members, they had already escaped. But she died in saving the passengers. So that was the thing. And engagement is the biggest challenge today, and it needs to be instilled in everyone, even in the students and even in company employees. Thank you.
Thank you. So other panelists, what would be your advice to HR leadership around this entire engagement challenge that we're facing?
Hello. what I will say is, when we talk about passion and how, you know, an employee joins on the first day and then the passion decreases the second, third day, as a practice, what we do is, you know, we have to handhold the employee, you know, onboard him properly, then handhold him for about 3 months, 6 months, so that he does not get disconnected, so that he is comfortable, he knows about the company, he is told about the company, he is told about his job role, he is told about the vision of the company. He is handheld till 6 months, till he is comfortable, and then he is, you know, put on hold.
So when you say handhold, you mean continuously realign org's perspective with his aspirations?
See, handhold, I mean, as an HR head, you know, I would assign some person, some employee, to be with him as a
continuously guide,
as a buddy. Okay. So that he is made comfortable. And see, initial 3 months to 6 months are important for him to be comfortable. Otherwise, he will leave.
Sure. Piyush, we can anything from your opinion?
Yeah. Actually, there are many companies, they have this buddy system. And onboarding, you understand onboarding? What is onboarding?
No, let me ask.
Actively engage people? Wake up, it's not over yet.
We are talking about onboarding. What is onboarding? Aapke toh sir se nikal jayegi baat. Ye onboarding,
anybody knows the answer?
मतलब आपका कंपनी में पहला दिन, ये समझ लो कि जब आप पहली बार किसी से मिलते हो तो अगर अच्छा इम्प्रेशन मिलता है तो आप कहते हो बहुत अच्छा बंदा है, और पहला इम्प्रेशन अगर खराब हो जाता है देन यू से बेकार है. जैसे मैं एक कंपनी ज्वाइन की मैंने, तो पहले दिन मैं जब ज्वाइन करने गया तो दो लोग मेरे से मिले, नंबर वन एंड नंबर टू ऑफ द कंपनी. वो दोनों चाय पी रहे थे. उन्होंने मेरे से नहीं पूछा कि चाय पियोगे कि नहीं. उन्होंने दोनों ने चाय पी. मैंने कहा मैं ज्वाइन करने आया हूँ. बोला अच्छा ठीक है, आप रिसेप्शन पे बैठ जाओ. तो रिसेप्शन पे बैठ गया मैं. उसके बाद वो एक बंदा अपने कैबिन में चला गया, दूसरा अपने कैबिन में चला गया, और मैं वहां अकेला बैठा. कोई कुछ बताने वाला नहीं, कैसी कंपनी. ऑन द अदर हैंड, कोई अगर मेरे को रिसीव करता है, I am well attended, briefed about the company, everything. और देखिए मैं इसमें एक important बात क्या है कि जैसे आपने सर्कस देखी होगी, सर्कस में शेर, हाथी, पक्षी, उन सब के कुछ कुछ करवाते हैं उनसे. Can you imagine कि आप जंगल में कोई शेर हो और उससे कुछ करवा लो, तो क्या होती है, ट्रेनिंग होती है उनकी, ट्रेनिंग एंड एजुकेशन. एक आईआईटी का इंजीनियर निकलता है और एक नॉर्मल कॉलेज का इंजीनियर निकलता है, फर्क होता है ना कुछ. सो दैट डिफरेंस इज द ट्रेनिंग एंड एजुकेशन गिवन टू देम. आपने देखा होगा कि हम लोग जितने भी इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेजेस हैं या मेडिकल कॉलेजेस हैं या एमबीए कॉलेजेस हैं, वी ऑल मेक मैनेजर्स, वी क्रिएट इंजीनियर्स, वी क्रिएट डॉक्टर्स, वी क्रिएट Liars and all. तो कोई भी कॉलेज जेंटलमैन पैदा नहीं करता. इंजीनियर बन गए, डॉक्टर बन गए, वकील बन गए, मैनेजर्स बन गए, लेकिन जेंटलमैन कोई नहीं है. हिंदुस्तान में केवल एक संस्था है जो जेंटलमैन बनाती है, जेंटलमैन पैदा करती है, वो है नेशनल डिफेंस अकेडमी, इंडियन आर्मी. जो एनडीए के पास आउट्स होते हैं, दे आर कॉल्ड जेंटलमैन कैडेट्स. ऑल द इंस्टीट्यूट्स, ऑल डिफेंस इंस्टीट्यूट्स, ये जो बच्चे पास आउट होके निकलते हैं, दे आर ऑल कॉल्ड जेंटलमैन कैडेट्स. कोई भी उसको कोई ये नहीं कहता ये इंजीनियर है, ये मैनेजर है, ये डॉक्टर है.
So all of you, the message I want to give is that all of you who are going to be the future managers of this country, you must be gentlemen also. Pehle gentlemen bano ya gentlewomen bano, uske baad achhe manager bano. And this all comes with training, education, learning, engagement. Okay, thank you.
Great. So, Pish, one question to you, dovetailing on what Vijay was talking about. What is it that our audience, students or employees can do to be more engaged? Because we believe that it's our responsibility to be engaged as much as it is organizations. What is it that they can do?
It's a collaborative approach, like as an employee, as a person, how you want to keep engaged yourself or how as an employer keep you engaged. On the lighter note, I'll just share one story. I hope many of you have read. So, like we have discussed the last question, like how crucial is your onboarding and all that. So HR manager went to heaven. How many of you have read that story? Okay, I'll just share in a minute. Like, so an HR manager met an accident and went to heaven. So at the gate, like the gatekeeper says that we have certain rules. So we give you, so from there you have to, we have two sections, one is hell and one is heaven. So you have to 24 hours, you have to stay in the hell and then 24 hours to heaven. So what happened, like the person says like, let me take you to the heaven first. So 24 hours, so she went, she got on a lift, went down, and then she saw in the hell the people, she met their, her own colleagues within the HR, and see they're enjoying, they're having a lot of happening there. They're discussing, they're having a parties and all that. She stayed 24 hours, and then time is over, then she was taken to heaven. So next day when she went to heaven, the she saw that people, they were floating in a cloud. It's very quiet and it's not much happening. So then the gatekeeper asked, like, what you want to choose? So she said, I definitely want to go heaven because there's much more happening and people are discussing together. There are a lot of my colleagues are there, so there's a lot of enjoyment. So gatekeeper asked, are you sure? Okay, yes, yes, I want to go to hell. So she was taken to the hell, and then when she entered there, she saw that this complete disorder, chaos. So then she asked, like, yesterday when I came here, that what happened? Like, she said that yesterday we were recruiting you, and today you are our staff. So welcome to the hell. So this is how, like, the engagement starts. Like, we have to engage from the day one. And the strategy from engaging from day one to, like, this is 6 months. So we have to do our part, and then the employee has to come up with his learning, and then keep learning. So learning is the main thing. We have to keep learning entire journey of our life. So I say my journey, I'm still a kid in the HR space. I say I've been into a lot of started my career in software development, and I moved to HR. And because that's because I'm confident of learning. I can learn easily, and I can work with the people. So I'm sitting on I've seen the stuff from both sides of the table, like when I was leading a team in the software development and how we have to go engage with the HR, and then now being in HR, how I have to engage the other teams who are working. So this is all, like, employee has to do his job, has to bring up more strategies and day to day, and same way the employee has to learn and then make a connect with the employee. So they have to engage and they go beyond the, find the why, purpose, why I'm here. So they have to find the why, and then again the organization has to do that kind of stuff.
Great. Thank you so much. I'm getting some gentle reminders that our time is up. So I want to keep like 5 minutes for question and answer if there are any from the audience. Well, let me just summarize a couple of points that we all agreed upon. One is employee engagement is not an employer's responsibility. It's an employee's responsibility as well. And I would rather take ownership than wait for somebody else to provide that on a silver platter. The other piece is what employers can do is marry the organization aspiration and goals with the aspiration of an individual. Wherein, Captain Bakhni was talking about how you're aligned towards the greater good in army. Third thing is passion. While your passion starts to fade away after some time, but it's again as a responsibility of everybody around you, but more so yours, to continuously keep that passion going forward. So you join this college with a lot of aspirations in mind. Continue those aspirations, passion along with you when you're studying. You may sit into the class or this auditorium and sleep, that's perfectly fine. But see what impact it's gonna do to your career at the end of the day.